Good day, everyone. We are the Group 1 from BSN 3A, and we are the proponents from the Visaya University of Science and Technology, from the Department of College of Nursing, and our study entitled Hysterectomy.
Chapter 1, The Problem and Its Setting. General Objective. This study aims to provide deeper theoretical and practical knowledge and information about hysterectomy. Additionally, to enhance student nurses' skills and capabilities in rendering effective nursing care to their clients with the same condition to promote health maintenance, health restoration, alleviate suffering, and provide comfort. Specific objectives. Specifically, this case study aims to perform a comprehensive physical assessment of the client's status to serve as a baseline data for subsequent evaluation, provide information about tests, examinations, and treatments. Understand the pathophysiology and etiology of the case being presented. Render effective nursing care for the client who undergoes hysterectomy. To formulate an appropriate drug study and nursing care plan utilizing the nursing process, and to develop a framework of study regarding the subject that can serve as a guide and foundation of future studies and research related to hysterectomy. Introduction. The term hysterectomy originates from the two Greek words hystero, which means uterus, and ectomy, which means resection removal from the human body. A hysterectomy is the surgical removal of the uterus. It ends menstruation and the ability to become pregnant. Reasons for this surgery include abnormal bleeding, uterine prolapse, and cancer. Depending on the reason for the surgery, a hysterectomy may also involve the removal of other organs and tissues, such as the ovaries or fallopian tubes. Moreover, this surgical procedure is indicated in several common gynecologic problems and is the only way to treat problems affecting the uterus. For certain conditions, however, hysterectomy may be the best choice.
For the client profile, name client B, address Cabanatuan City, date of birth, July 22, 1983, age 31 years old, gender female, civil status married, height 162 cm, weight 52 kg, nationality Filipino, religion Roman Catholic, occupation housewife, GTPAL, G2, T1, P1, A0, L2.
For the physical examination, upon interpretation, the areas that presented with significant changes are the chest with an irregular respiratory rate of 26 cycles per minute upon auscultation, the surgical site from the abdomen is bleeding, and then extremities that exhibit pale fingernails and palmar pallor.
Here we have the book-based pathophysiology of hysterectomy. While it remains unclear as to how adenomyosis develops and there are only correlations established with the condition according to Hapman and Company 2016, adenomyosis is usually in women aged between 40s and 50s, had pregnancy before, had uterine surgery, has a history of smoking and ectopic pregnancy. It starts with the endometrium invaginating the basalis layer of the myometrial layer, which then causes endometrial tissues to be deposited to the myometrium. Now this deposit accumulates, causing the myometrium to enlarge with reflex in the size of the uterus. The abnormality results in pain during menstruation and intercourse, heavy and prolonged menstruation, passing of blood clots, and bleeding in between menstruations. The only definitive treatment for symptoms related to adenomyosis is hysterectomy, if future fertility is not put into consideration.
For the laboratory results, the table shows the laboratory result of the patient for a complete blood test that contains the white blood cells, red blood cells, hemoglobin, hematocrit, and platelets. The table shows the level of red blood cells, hemoglobin, and hematocrit lower than the normal range, while the platelet count is slightly beyond the normal range. Cross-matching type test. The cross-match is routinely used as a final step of pre-transfusion compatibility testing. The purposes of the compatibility testing are to detect irregular antibodies, errors in ABO grouping, and clerical errors in patient identification and result recording. Pelvic ultrasound. It is the most common imaging modality used to evaluate gynecologic symptoms, with a sensitivity between 75 to 88% and specificity from 67 to 93%, according to some researchers, year 2009. Ultrasonography is often preferred because it is more widely available and significantly more cost-effective for patients.
We are now moving on to the chapter 4 of our case presentation, which is the nursing care plans. For our first NCP, for the subjective assessment, parang nanghihina ako, as verbalized by the client. For the objective assessment, palmar pallor of the extremities, a decreased RBC, hemoglobin, and hematocrit levels. The client also shows bleeding. Vital signs taken as follows. The temperature is 37.3 degrees Celsius. Respiratory rate is 26 cycles per minute. Pulse rate is 122 beats per minute. For the blood pressure, it is 90 over 60 millimeter of mercury. For our nursing diagnosis, it is ineffective tissue perfusion related to bleeding as manifested by palmar pallor of extremities and decreased RBC, hemoglobin, and hematocrit levels. For our outcomes identification, the client will return to maximum tissue perfusion to vital organs by exhibiting normal vital signs and laboratory results free from bleeding. For our planning, short term, after 8 hours of nursing intervention, the client will demonstrate increased tissue perfusion and prevent complications of bleeding as evidenced by normal blood pressure, respiratory rate, and pulse rate. And then after 5 days of nursing interventions, the client will demonstrate normal perfusion as evidenced by client's laboratory result and absence of bleeding on the genital area. For our nursing interventions, independent interventions include, first is to monitor vital signs, palpate peripheral pulses, and note capillary refill, assess urinary output and characteristics, evaluate changes in mentation. The rationale for this is, these are indicators of the adequacy of systemic perfusion, fluid or blood needs, and developing complications. Next would be to inspect the dressings and noting color, amount, and odor of drainage. Weigh pads and compare with the dry weight if the patient is bleeding heavily. The rationale is proximity of large blood vessels to the operative site and or potential for alteration of clotting mechanism, increasing the risk of postoperative hemorrhage. Then, we're going to encourage bed rest. Our rationale for this is it helps in maximizing blood flow. Afterwards, we're going to assist and instruct in foot and leg exercises and ambulate as soon as able. The rationale, movement enhances circulation and prevents stasis complications. Next is that we're going to encourage complete bed rest. The rationale is it helps in maximizing blood flow. Moving on to the dependent nursing interventions. First one would be to administer IV fluids as indicated or ordered by the physician. The rationale is that sufficient fluid intake maintains adequate filling pressures and optimizes cardiac output needed for tissue perfusion. Then we're going to administer antibiotics as ordered by the physician. The rationale is that post-surgical clients are at risk for infection. And last but not the least for our dependent nursing interventions is we're going to administer blood transfusion as ordered by the physician. The rationale is that the physician will order blood transfusion to replace blood loss due to hemorrhage. Sufficient fluid intake maintains adequate filling and pressures and optimizes cardiac output needed for the tissue perfusion. For our evaluation, for the short term, is that after 8 hours of nursing interventions, the client demonstrated increased tissue perfusion and prevented complications of bleeding as evidenced by normal blood pressure, respiratory rate, and pulse rate. After 5 days of nursing interventions, the client demonstrated normal perfusion as evidenced by normal laboratory results and absence of bleeding on the genital area. The goal was met.
NCP number 2. For the assessment, subjective data. Masakit doon sa parte ng inoperahan, as verbalized by the client. Using Wong-Baker's pain rating scale, client reported pain of 7 out of 10. Objective data, assistive activity pattern, abdominal bleeding. Vital signs taken as follows. Temperature 37.3 degrees Celsius. Respiration rate 26 CPM, pulse rate 122 beats per minute, BP 90/60 mmHg. For the nursing diagnosis, pain secondary to surgical operation as evidenced by reported pain and limited range of motion. Outcome identification. Client will be able to resume activities free of pain and discomfort. For the planning, for the short term, after 8 hours of nursing intervention, the client will verbalize a decrease in perceived pain from 7 to 10 to 4 out of 10. Long term, after 2 to 3 weeks of nursing interventions, the client will be able to exhibit behaviors and activity indicating absence of pain and discomfort. For the nursing intervention, independent, monitor vital signs. Rationale, this will be used as baseline data and changes in vital signs may be used for rough estimate of pain. Evaluate pain regularly, noting characteristic of pain, noting verbal reports, non-verbal cues, moaning, crying, restlessness, diaphoresis, and rapid breathing, and hemodynamic response, BP or heart rate changes. Rationale, variation of appearance and behavior of patients in pain may present a challenge in assessment. Most patients with pain appear ill, distracted, and focused on pain. Verbal history and deeper investigations of precipitating factors should be postponed until pain is relieved. Respiration may be increased as a result of pain and associated anxiety. Release of stress-induced catecholamines increases heart rate and BP. Obtain full descriptions of pain from patient including location, intensity, 0 to 10, duration, characteristic, dull or crushing, and radiation. Assess patient to quantify pain by comparing it to other experiences. Rationale, pain is a subjective experience and must be described by the patients or the client. Provides baseline for comparison to aid in determining the effectiveness of therapy, resolution or progression of the problem. Educate patient of pain management approach that has been ordered, including therapies, medication, administration, side effects, and complications. Rationale, one of the most important steps toward improved control of pain is a better patient understanding of the nature of pain, its treatment, and the role patient needs to play in pain control. Encourage diversional activities like watching TV or reading books. Rationale, refocuses attention, promotes relaxation, and may enhance coping abilities. Dependent nursing interventions. Administer analgesics as prescribed to maximal dosage as needed. Rationale, to maintain acceptable level of pain. Evaluation, short term. After 8 hours of nursing intervention, the client was verbalized a decrease in perceived pain. Long term, after 2 to 3 weeks of nursing intervention, the client was able to exhibit behaviors and activity indicating the absence of pain and discomfort. And the goal was met.
For the first drug study, generic name hydromorphone, pregnancy risk category C, dosage route, oral or tablet 2 mg, 4 mg, and 8 mg, for extended release tablets 8 mg, 12 mg, 16 mg, and 32 mg. Initiate treatment with hydromorphone tablets in a dosing range of 2 mg to 4 mg orally every 4 to 6 hours. Classifications, narcotic analgesic. For the indication, hydromorphone is used for moderate to severe acute pain and severe chronic pain. Adverse reaction, CNS, weakness, chills, headache, tremor, paresthesia, nystagmus, increase intracranial pressure, syncope-based alteration, involuntary muscle contractions, and presyncope flushing, CV bradycardia, palpitations, tachycardia, hypotension, hypertension, GI, diarrhea, constipation, abdominal pain, decreased appetite, renal, urinary retention, respiratory dyspnea, dermatologic, urticaria, rash, hyperhidrosis, respiratory, bronchospasm, laryngospasm, psychiatric, agitation, nervousness, anxiety, depression, hallucination, disorientation, insomnia, abnormal dreams, other physical or psychological drug dependence, and drug tolerance. For the nursing consideration, before, review the 12 rights of drug administration. Check and verify the right drug's name or label, route, dosage, time, frequency, and expiration date. Verify the right patient and check or review the client's history to drug interactions, medications, previously given or diet, and also client's allergies. Inform the client about their right to refuse the drug therapy and the reason for the drug therapy. During, monitor the client's vital signs, educate the client about the adverse effects of the drugs, and instruct them to seek attention immediately when experiencing adverse effects. Advise client to adhere to the scheduled time of use of the drug to maintain relief from pain. Monitor fluid intake and output. Stay alert for urinary retention. Monitor bowel elimination pattern. If constipation occurs, intervene as appropriate. Assess neurologic status. Implement safety measures such as raising side rails as needed to prevent injury. Give the client enough autonomy to refuse the medication after thoroughly explaining the effects. After, evaluate the client for any adverse reactions and record and thoroughly document the implemented care. Inform client that drug may cause constipation or urinary retention. Encourage high fiber diet and high fluid intake. Stress importance of taking drug only as prescribed. Point out that drug may cause psychological or physical dependence. Teach client and caregiver about appropriate safety measures to prevent injury. Monitor any improvements in symptoms. And lastly, document and record.
For generic name, ampicillin, pregnancy risk category is B. For the dosage and route, oral 250 to 500 mg capsule every 6 hours. For the IV and IM, 250 mg to 5 grams every 6 hours. For classification, broad spectrum antibiotic. For indications, ampicillin is used as a treatment for bacterial infection. For the adverse reaction, integumentary, erythema multiforme, exfoliative dermatitis, rash, urticaria, anaphylaxis. For CNS, fever and seizure. For the GI, diarrhea, enterocolitis, glossitis, nausea, oral candidiasis, neuromembranous colitis, stomatitis, and vomiting. For the hematolymphatic, agranulocytosis, anemia, eosinophilia, leukopenia, thrombocytopenia purpura. For the respiratory, laryngeal stridor. For the nursing consideration, before the drug therapy, review the 12 rights of drug administration. Check and verify the right drug's name or level, route, dose, time, frequency, and expiration date. Verify the right client and check or review the client history to drug interaction, medication previously given, or diet and client's allergies. Inform the client about the right to refuse the drug therapy and the reason for the drug therapy. During the drug therapy, monitor the client's vital signs, educate the client about the adverse effects of the drugs, and instruct them to seek attention immediately when experiencing the adverse reaction. Administer the right dose at the right time and route. And after the drug therapy, evaluate the client for any adverse reactions and record and truly document the implemented care. Stress importance of taking drug only as prescribed. point out that drug may cause overdose, teach the client and caregiver about appropriate safety measures to prevent injury, monitor for improvements in symptoms, document and record, give IV intermittently to prevent vein irritation.
For the Chapter 4 summary of findings, from the data gathered, the health problems of the client have been identified. The client was diagnosed with adenomyosis. The study has rendered awareness for the student nurses to provide effective and quality nursing care. The following are the gathered findings. The first one, upon admission, the client is admitted to the post anesthesia care unit or PACU for the management of hysterectomy. Number 2. Upon head-to-toe physical assessment, the client had abnormal findings. Chest with an irregular respiratory rate of 26 cycles per minute upon auscultation. Extremities that exhibited pale fingernails and palmar pallor, and then the abdomen, which exhibited bleeding in the surgical site. 3. A CBC and cross-matching type test was ordered for the bleeding and possible blood transfusion. A pelvic ultrasound was also performed to assess the organs and the structures for possible complications. 4. The student nurses made a study about the disease and made a study about the drugs and medications that are appropriate for the client. And lastly, number 5, the student nurses also formulated and performed nursing interventions to promote the client's health status.
Conclusions. From the data gathered in the findings, the conclusions are as follows. Health problems of the client are lessened through nursing interventions. The client encountered problems such as subfertility and dysmenorrhea because of the invagination of the endometrial tissues into the myometrium, which caused the adenomyosis. The client's health status is improved because student nurses followed the 10 rights of drug administration, right nursing interventions, and appropriate medical treatment.
Recommendations. For the client to recover and avoid further complications from the condition, recommendations would include but not limited to the following. Medications. Take medications accordingly as prescribed by the physician. Instruct the patient and the family to complete the whole duration of the drug. Environment and/or exercise. As much as possible, stay in an area with a clean, low humidity, and comfortable temperature. Minimize time outdoors as this may put the client at risk for possible infection. Treatment. Orient the client about her condition and necessary information, or treatment and recovery process as the right education about the client's condition can alleviate family anxiety and emotionally prepare them for the challenges that they may face. Health teaching. Advise to take medications on time with right dose. Instruct the client and the family about the risk of not adhering to the medication regimen. Check with the physician before taking any new medication. Remind the client to express any discomfort in order for the healthcare provider to carry out certain measures, and advise the client to establish direct open communication with the healthcare practitioner to link care needs. OPD or checkup. Instruct the patient to adhere to the recommended diet and exercise, and remind the client about the following visits and succeeding visits prescribed by the healthcare provider. Diet. Diet must be focused on soft, solid foods including broiled, baked, and grilled lean meats. Eat 6 meals a day and keep portions small. Continue to avoid raw fruits, vegetables, and other hard foods such as popcorn. Properly chewing the food is very important at this stage. Lastly, spirituality. Encourage the client and the family to communicate and pray to God.